In this video from ITFreeTraining, I will look at organizational units in Active Directory and shadow groups. Using these effectively allows you to model Active Directory based on your business environment. Organizational units, or OUs, allow you to divide up the objects in your Active Directory environment based on your business needs. For example, you could divide users and computers based on geographical locations, departments, computer types, or any way you require. If you start with a basic OU, in this case called New York, in a large site, an OU like this will soon become full of objects. OUs are like folders on a hard disk. On a hard disk, you would create new directories to organize files. Like the directories on a hard disk, OUs form the containers that allow Active Directory objects to be organized. In this case, I will create two new OUs under New York called Users and Computers. This is one way to separate objects in Active Directory. In the real world, it is up to the individual administrator to decide which OUs they want to create and where they want to put the objects. In a lot of cases, administrators will choose to create organizational units that mirror the business. In this example, two additional OUs are created called Sales and Marketing. In these OUs are placed the users for sales and marketing. Organizing Active Directory objects like this helps you sort out your users and computers based on your business needs, but there are other advantages to creating a structure like this and sorting your users. Later in the course, I will cover group policy in a lot more detail. Group policy allows the administrator to create settings and apply them to users. Group policies are applied to OUs. In this example, I would create a group policy and apply it to the sales users OU like this. The group policy would allow the administrator to configure settings for the user, like setting their wallpaper or default printer. The next question that arises is, could sorting users into OUs like this also be used to apply permissions? The answer to this is no. Using a structure like this cannot be used to define permissions, say to a file share. This is the fundamental difference between an OU and a group. An OU is used to sort your users, but like files on your hard disk, the user only exists in one location. Groups, on the other hand, contain any number of users from any part of the domain and thus offer more flexibility than organizational units. In order to use the OU structure that you have created for permissions, Microsoft introduces the concept called a shadow group. A shadow group is a regular Active Directory group that simply contains all the users in the OU. In this example, if I create a shadow group for the sales OU, this group will contain all the users from the sales OU. Now, if you want to give all the sales users access to a file share, you simply use this group. To keep the shadow group up to date, you will need to update its membership each time a user is added or removed from the sales OU. It is possible to create a script to do this process automatically, but this will need to be configured. Later in the course, I will look at fine granular password policy. This allows different password policies to be applied to the domain. For example, a particular set of users could be configured to require a longer password than others. Fine granular password policy must be configured using a group. In this case, you would more than likely want to configure it to an OU. For example, if you had a secure department, you would more than likely put all the users in this department in the same OU. This is a good example of where a shadow group would come in handy. OUs can also be used to separate computers. In this example, I could create separate OUs for desktop and laptop computers. This comes in handy for using group policy. You could now create a group policy for computers that contain all the common settings for computers. For example, settings like the desktop wallpaper and screensaver could be configured here. Next, you could create separate laptop and desktop group policies, which contain settings that are just for those types of computers. Both of these OUs could also have group policy applied to them that configured settings that were specific to desktops and laptops. This gives you a lot of flexibility, allowing you to configure the OUs in Active Directory to match your business requirements. In any Active Directory environment, there will be a number of default OUs created when Active Directory is first installed. These OUs cannot be deleted, and only one of these can have group policy applied to it. The first one is built-in. The OU contains all the user accounts that normally exist only in the local accounts database. When a server is promoted to a domain controller, these local accounts are moved into Active Directory database. For most Active Directory administration, you do not need to use this OU. The next default OU is users. This will contain the default users that are created when Active Directory is first installed. For example, the default administrators account. Since this OU does not allow group policy to be applied, you more than likely will move users that you create in this OU to another OU that you create, like the New York OU used in the previous example. The next OU is the computers OU. When you add a computer to the domain, the computer account for the computer is put in this OU. Like the other OUs, group policy cannot be applied to this OU, so you are more than likely going to move the computer account to another OU after it has been created. The last default OU is domain controllers. The domain controllers OU contains all the computer accounts for all the domain controllers for that domain. Unlike the other OUs, group policy can be applied to this OU. Now that all the theory on organizational units has been covered, I will now change to my Windows Server 2008 R2 domain controller to look at how to use organizational units. First of all, open Active Directory Users and Computers from the Start menu. From Active Directory Users and Computers, you can see the first default OU that I talked about, built-in. In here, you can see the user accounts that are shared between domain controllers in the domain. If you were to create a user in this OU, this user account would only be available to domain controllers. The next OU is computers. When a computer is added to the domain, the computer account by default will automatically be put in this OU. The next OU is the domain controllers OU. When a server is promoted to a domain controller, the computer account for that server will move or be created in this OU. The next OU is foreign security principles. I did not mention this OU before because it is not an OU that you would normally use in day-to-day administration. When you have multiple domains connected by trusts, you may see accounts appear in here. These are created automatically by Active Directory and are used to help bridge the two domains. In normal day-to-day administration, you would not need to go into this OU. The next OU is Managed Service Accounts. This is a feature of Windows Server 2008 R2 and Windows 7. If your schema is not up to date, this OU may not be available. This OU will only be used with managed service accounts in Windows Server 2008 R2 and Windows 7. Like the Foreign Security Principles OU, this is not an OU you would generally use for day-to-day administration. The last default OU is the Users OU. This contains all the default users and groups created when the Active Directory domain was first installed. Additional user accounts and groups may also be created in here. For example, if the read-only domain controllers group did not exist, these groups will be created when you start using read-only domain controllers. Normally, when you create a new user, you will decide then where to put the user. Otherwise, this is the default location users will be put when software creates the user for you. I have already created an OU for New York, and under this is another OU called Users. Under Users is another OU called Marketing. To create a new OU under Users, right-click Users and select New Organizational Unit. Once I enter in the name of the organizational unit, I also get the option under this, Protect Container from Accidental Deletion. It is not that often that you will make changes to your OUs once they are created, so it is a good idea to keep this option on. Once the OU is created, since Protect Container from Accidental Deletion was selected, notice what happens when I attempt to move the OU to another location. Windows will give me a prompt telling me that moving an OU will have an effect on your environment, particularly if you are using group policy. Once I press Yes to this dialog and proceed, notice that Windows will give me an error message saying that access is denied. Until Protect Container from Accidental Deletion is deselected, I will not be able to delete or move the OU. By default, some OUs are hidden, and some tabs will be hidden when looking at the properties for OUs. To see all of these, select the View menu and then select the option Advanced Features. If I now go back to the Sales OU and open the properties, since Advanced Features are now switched on, I will see all the tabs. Some of these tabs would previously not have appeared. Like a lot of objects in Active Directory, you have the option on the General tab to enter some information about the OU. In the case of the New York OU, I could enter information about the physical location of the office that it is being used for. On the Managed tab, you can configure a user that is associated with this OU. Once I press Change and select a user, that user will be associated with this OU. This is only provided for informational purposes. Configuring a user here does not give the user any additional permissions. On the Object tab, you can see the canonical name of the object. This is sometimes useful to copy and paste into scripts or documentation. At the bottom is the tick box Protect Object from Accidental Deletion. If you want to move or delete the OU, you will need to clear this tick box first. Once your OUs are created, you will want to move some objects into them. If I go to the user's OU, it is simply a matter of selecting the users that I want and dragging and dropping them to the OU required, in this case, the sales OU. Once again, I will get a message saying moving the object can have an effect on your environment. It is important to remember this fact when making changes. The user may need to reboot their computer when making changes like this in order for the changes to take effect. If I open the computer OU, when a computer is added to the domain, the computer account for that computer will be created in here. Since group policy cannot be applied to this OU, you will more than likely want to move the computer account after it is created. The process is the same as for users. Drag and drop it where you want it. When a computer is joined to the domain, the computer will ask for a restart. One trick I like to do is before the restart is to move the computer account to the correct location. By doing this, when the computer is restarted, the computer account will be in the correct location. If you move the computer account later on, you will need to perform a second restart after the computer account has been moved. In some cases, you may want to perform some testing before deploying software or settings on your network. A lot of administrators will create a new OU, for example, a testing OU. It is a simple matter of moving the computer accounts that you want to use for testing into this OU. The same principle applies if you migrate users to a new system, or perhaps you want to create a pilot group to test some new settings or software before deploying to the rest of the users. Create a separate OU and move the objects required into this OU. With the advanced features enabled, notice that also additional OUs are present, like Lost and Found. The Lost and Found OU is the home of orphaned objects in Active Directory. Under certain conditions in Active Directory, an object may become orphaned and moved in here. For example, this could happen if an object is created and deleted while still in the process of being replicated around the domain. If you see any objects in here, it is up to you to review these and see if you still require any of these objects. At the bottom, there are some additional OUs that are for more advanced Active Directory administration. For this reason, I will not go into these in this video. This covers all the basics for organizational units in Active Directory. To review what we have learned, what is an organizational unit? An organizational unit is a way of organizing Active Directory objects into containers. This is the same way you would organize files on your hard disk into directories. Next, what is the difference between an OU and a group? OUs are essentially used for group policy and delegation of administration. Covered later in the course, group policy is directly applied to an organizational unit. Delegation of administration allows you to pick an administrator or administrators to look after all the objects in a particular OU. For example, using delegation, you could grant a single user administrative rights to all the objects under the New York OU used in the previous example. The important thing to remember with OUs is that objects, like the files on a hard disk, exist only in the one location. In contrast to groups, groups are primarily used to provide access to resources. Groups are generally used with objects, files, and directories. Groups differ from OUs in that objects, like users and computers, can exist in multiple groups. Understanding how both work and how to use them effectively will greatly improve your ability to support your domain. I hope you've enjoyed this video from IT Free Training. For more videos for this course and others, please visit our website or YouTube channel. Thanks for watching.